Hello, my dear friends, fellow travelers, photographers, and my dear viewer around the world. Welcome to Chrisley Travel Channels. In today, this last episode, we are going to bring you a few more places of interest in Iran. And it will be basically three historical significant places. And I'm going to give you a quick preview before I go into the journey proper. Besides just now you've seen, we are going to cover a historical village, right? And this village is called Abyaneh Historical Village. That will be our first place of interest. Then we are moving on to a Jame Mosque, which have close to 1,200 years of history. And then we move on to the third and also the last place of interest is Monuments and Khan Museum, which have also at least 600 years of history. And that will be our journey for today. And for those who are first time with me, let have an idea of the whereabout of Iran. Iran is a nation in the Middle East, as can be seen in this map. And Iran have been actually also like most other countries have been divided into many provinces. And in our today travels, we'll be cover two provinces. And at the same time, just for knowledge, that for those of you who are interested to visit Iran, that take note that Iran have quite a number of cities in the central and southern part that have airport. And this also where it's for the convenience of any tourist who would like to embark on the trip that want to reduce the time by taking flight, right? So here will be actually the intent place for our visit in today, and we are cover a few places. As we say that just now we have three places. We'll cover both in the Isfahan province as well as Kerman province. And in Isfahan province we'll cover two places of interest, and in Kerman one only. And just for anyone of you who are interested to travel to Iran and would like to follow through my travel trail, and you can look at this map, this route maps that I have taken in the year 2017. And actually we are flying straight from Tehran, the capital city of Iran, all the way to Shiraz, where is the place where the Iran most historical places where the birth of the Persian Empire. And then we take on route trips all the way to the east, and then move up north back to Tehran. So this could be a useful guide for those of you who wish to visit all the places that I've introduced in my travelogues from episode 1 to episode 12, which today is the last one. So let's look at this very interesting Abyaneh historical village. All this while I have never introduced to any of the travelers on any villages, but except this one, it must have a reason for being need to be introduced in this last episode of my travelogues. And this Abyaneh village is considered one of the oldest and the compact Iranian villages, and is located in the foothill of Karkas Mountains, which is about 70 km southeast of Kazan city in Isfahan province. And this village is 2,300 meters above sea level, assessed that it will be a freezing cold during the winter months. Now this village remote location have helped preserve the culture and tradition of its founder and away from war damages. As you understand that there are many wars have took place in Iran over the last 2,000 years. And this village seemed to be escape from the damage, the war damages. And let's move on this slide to have an idea of whereabout is this Abyaneh village. As you can see, it's almost close to the borders of this Isfahan province. And when we visit this village, right, and this village, this ancient village, I would like to say that it's believed to have about 2,000 years of history, and still retain, you know, the work from the historical, so-called the work from the Sassanid era till the most recent era. Some of the historical work, including the mosque, right, with Mihrabs, from the Seljukians era, and also the temple of Herpak, right? So these are the very key evidence of this well-preserved village until today. Now, many of the elderly residents still speak a very unique called Middle Persian language, and earlier versions of the called Farsi language that largely disappear, you know, in this recent era. I mean, even few hundred years ago, it started disappearing from Iranian, this piece of land. Now, on top of that, the villagers' clothing is another so-called example of great antiquity of this village. Now, the village is registered in the Iranian or Iran's Natural Heritage so-called list in the year 1975. Now, from the image you are looking at it now, you find that these are some of the village, the earth building that we found at the foothill of this village, and was actually very much damaged due to the war. And also you can find that there are a lot of caves that dug into the face of the cliff of the hill. And I was told that these are the places where some of the residents are taking the shelter, right? This is another instance we found a big cave along the way. And when upon arriving at the, not exactly the hilltop, but somewhere close to the higher level of these mountains, and this is a scene that you can come across, and in fact this is a scene that along the way you can see that the remoteness of this village from the urbanized and modern Iranian city. So here, this is a place where it's almost the end of our journey, where the village is just nearby. Now, just a bit more to share about what's so unique about this village. Now, the dwellings here are well harmonized with the surroundings and climates, and the use of the so-called natural material, such as rocks and mud brick obtained from the terrains around this Abyaneh, which contain high content of so-called iron oxide. And this gives the buildings here a reddish color looks. And similarly, with the surrounding terrain color, right, in other words, it's blend in the color of the building and the surrounding colors of the earth, right? The terrains are almost the same because they're using the same material. And it's for this reason that this village is sometimes referred or known as the Red Valley, a village, sorry. So that is a view of how the village look like, as can be seen in this image. As you see just now, the terrain color, and as well that the building now is actually camouflaged in a way. Now, this village is not only a living museum, right, of tradition and architecture style, but it's also a fine example of human adaptation to nature. And the move on a bit to get to know a bit more about the village, and the entire village is formed by many narrow and sloped stone paved lanes, as you can see now from this image. Although this is not very steep, but a certain part of the slope are the lane are much slopey. And beside that, they are so crumbling with a lot of mud brick houses, you can as can be seen, and with latex wooden windows and door, and so-called fragile cantilever wooden balcony. This is something another main feature, or rather attraction, of the dwelling in this village. So let's move on with some images and see how interesting is this village to explore. Here in this image, you can see the cantilever balcony. It is constructed in such a manner, all right? And so it's very unique. And you also can notice there are doors that open outward in the higher floor, right? It's again very, very unique. In the sand. So just look at this building around the villages. And see, interestingly, some of the roof, I was told some of the roof of low-level dwellings became the courtyard, you know, for the houses as a higher up the slope. And also with dwelling, that in this case you can see that they built over the village lane and forming a tunnel. So you can see that the tunnel that we are passing through in this image, right above it is a dwelling or is a resident house. And you will notice in this image, I have actually particularly highlight a picture, right, that's mounted on a pole, right, next to the this so-called the tunnel. And this is a picture of the deceased soldier from this village, because there are many volunteers, many youth have joined to become the army, the soldier, and they have actually was killed in the war, and therefore in order to commemorate and also to appreciate the contribution of this youth, they have actually purposely put up the picture on the village, right? So this is all the surrounding scene of the village. Rarely you see any other modern building material is used. All are use of mud bricks and material obtained from the surrounding. Now you can see in this picture on the left, right on the lane itself, at right the center, there's actually a depression into it. In fact, this serves as a drainage channel to run off the rain waters, right? And on the right, of course, is actually the arch of entry to one of the building. The lane are generally very narrow, as can be seen in all these images. And because the village was built on a hill slope, so you can see that you have a lot of steps to climb, and all these steps are quite fairly narrow as well. And the use of stone is very common here as a building material. Our visit was during the month of March, and or the later part of March. So it's still in the spring season. So of course, and then at the altitude of 2,300 meters above sea level, the cold climate, so you can see a lot of trees still leafless. More images of the cantilever wooden balcony. And this is how the balcony is supported. So the Persian influence, the Islamic value is fairly great here. So you can see some of this much later building that's constructed. This is actually in the main street of the village when we arrived, and just purpose take picture of this front facade of the building and his gate. Some of the residence dwellings doors. You can see from the image the age, the aging of the wooden door. And as usual, if you notice that the door knocker, they have actually difference, although come in pair, they are not the same. And for those who have yet to, first time meet me, then you will ask why there's just a unsimilar door knocker, although it's come in a pair, but it's different from each other. I will recommend you to revisit some of visit some of my earlier episode to have a better understanding of it, which I've actually illustrated, highlighted quite clearly. More images of the door knocker. This is one of the uniqueness of Iran. And the clothing of the resident, as I said earlier, is so much different from the attire from the other part of Iran. So you can see from this image. More narrow lane view. You can see that the lane, the central part of the lane is actually the drain channel. More images now. So you can still find some residents on the street or on the lanes. In this image, the above this lane is basically is the dwellings right above it. As I mentioned, they are form of building houses over the lane because of the space constraint. So it's considered a very compact village. The view at the low level of this on the paved roads, right in front of us is where the so-called the drain channels. So more images of a poster that the place that you can find in this village as you walk around. And of course, on the image, in this case on the left, is actually the picture of a missing child. And this image will show you the attire, the uniqueness of attire of the resident here, that's on the left. And on the right is a couple, young couple that we met with this lovely baby. Here is, I think there are not many so-called hotels, and this is one of them, and we are actually having our lunch here. So we are in the so-called the lobby, hotel lobby. And this is the courtyard of the hotel lobby, of the hotel that we are in. Some of the decoration on the wall. And we are treated with this local candy and local tea and coffee. It's very unique, but a word of wine is very, very sweet. The candy is very, very sweet. And we also found one or two stalls that selling the local products, more towards textures and attire. And also some handicraft, decorative handicraft. It's a springtime, so it's a cherry blossom season, so we also have been welcome. And the next stop of our journey will be to this Jame Mosque. And before we go on further, let know about Jame Mosque background. Jame Mosque is one of the oldest mosques located in the near a town located in Isfahan province in Iran. Now, the mosque is dated back to the 8th century. Since then, it has been constructed incrementally till the current size. Now, the octagonal minarets was only added to the mosque almost 600 years later, which is during the 14th century. And after thousands of years later, this mosque still well preserved in its original architecture, which unlike other mosques in Isfahan and Yang, this mosque has no aiwans and dome, right? It's something that very different, right? It's also lack of tile works, which due to its age, dated way back to the 14th century or earlier. So in other words, this 1,200 years old mosque is so old that the any modern building material, such as tiles and things like that, it have yet the evolved. I mean, so yet to be found. So therefore, it's expected to see something very, very original, very, very dated back to ancient time. So again, it's a worth visiting mosque, in my humble opinion. And let's move on then, we'll go on with more information. So the location of this mosque is still within the Isfahan province, and in this near to this town, Naim, right? As shown, it's again, it now is on the, also at the border, but at the southern border of Isfahan province. This is the model of this mosque. So you can see that completely you are absent of domes. And at the same time, you see that only the minaret, and as I say that this minaret was added 600 years later from the day the mosque is founded. This is some of the external view of this mosque with this lately constructed minaret, brick minaret. Wind tower is against a very common scene, as this area is also considered a desert zone in a way, with very hot climates, particularly during the summer. This is a view in the courtyard of the mosque. Clay brick is a main construction material. Look at the facade design. This is a ceiling of the in one part of the mosque building. This mosque having a flat roof in a way, it can be seen earlier in the model. This is a prayer area. You can see the how intensive is this carved relief on the wall, and as well on the columns and the arches. A closer view. Now, since we are up to this part, it's important to note also the mosque contains a central rectangular courtyard, which just now we have seen one. And right below the courtyard is a dark basement, which believed originally used as a Zoroastrian fire temple. And for those who again want to know about what is Zoroastrian, is a kind of civilizations found in this part of the world. And the Zoroastrian actually they worship sun, and therefore their temple they call it fire temple. So you can find out more also in my previous episodes of my journey to Iran. And also in this mosque, beside the underground basement chamber, they also have underground water channels that run underneath the mosque. And the mosque connected right to the water channel by stairway to a chamber above, and the basement used as a prayers chamber during the hot summer as well as the cold winter. So while looking at some of these relief or carving on the surface of this building, is so intricately and beautiful. And this is basically the passageway that leading to the underground chamber. And this is the underground chambers. And one very unique thing is that you notice that those now in the present modern day we have electricity, but in the past, remember 1,200 years ago, or at least 600-700 years ago, there's no such thing of so-called electricity, and the lighting is all depend on, you know, the burning of fuel, coal, firewood, and so on. But in this underground chamber, during the daytime, they rely on the lighting by using the daylight thing. I will share with you how they did it, you know. What you see in the image now, of course, they have been installed the lighting for the visitor to view during the daytime. And this is actually the passageway connecting to the water channel, quite a narrow one. Now, this is actually the ventilation shaft. Now, this ventilation shaft, of course, as we know that it can serve two purposes. It serves also as a daylighting purposes or skylight at the same time for ventilations. And on top of that, they also have many small ventilation hole, not even use ventilation hole, so a shaft or hole dug through the ceiling of the chamber. And on top of it is where at this courtyard area they place a piece of marble tiles. This marble tile is not opaque, actually it's a semi-transparent, so the light, the sunlight wouldn't then shine through this semi-transparent piece of marble tile and then provide the lighting to the basement below. This is how they get the lighting for the sub-basement, or in this case the dug-in basement. So one more thing I need to highlight to you that the elaborated carving on the stone and on the wooden Mercury pulpit and also the organic geometrical design are astonishingly beautiful, as I shared with you just now in some of the close-up images. As to date, right, this mosque is still in use and is protected by the Iran's cultural heritage organizations. Remember, this is one of the most undisturbed traditional ancient mosques in Iran, with a history of not less than 1,200 years. And the last stop of our today will be this Shah Ne'mat-ollah Vali mausoleums at the town called Mahan, right? And these mausoleums have an age of about 600 years old. So location now is no longer in the province of Isfahan, but is actually in the province of Kerman. As can be seen in this map. Now, this Shah Ne'mat-ollah Vali Mausoleum, as I mentioned, that is near 600 years old, and historical complex located in the Mahan town in Kerman province, which contained the mausoleum of Shah Ne'mat-ollah Vali, right, a renowned Iranian mystic and poet. Shah Ne'mat-ollah Vali died in the year 1431, aged over 100 years. Now, this shrine was erected in 1436 in his honor and become a pilgrimage site. The shrine complex comprises of four courtyards, a reflected pool, right, a mosque, and a twin minaret, which now can be seen in the image, which covered with turquoise tile from the bottom up to the cupola. So you can see how intensive is the tower is done to this dome. And this is because of that, this is also one of the iconic feature of this mausoleum in Iran. So some of the external view of this mausoleum. Look at the towers, as well as the other part of the roof of this mosque can be seen clearly in this image. The two minaret is also fully tiled. And as this is a place is also near to the desert zone, but also to the some of the mountain range, so the snow-capped mountains still between view from this mosque complex or mausoleum complex. Inside the mausoleums, right, this is some of the internal feature and decorations. Now, the small room where the Ne'mat-ollah Vali pray and mediates, right, contain outstanding brasslings and tile works, which I'm sharing with you now. The tile works and the seven ancient wooden door are the main attraction for the visitor. So what we are visiting, what we are looking for is all those intricated plastering works and decoration in this 600 years old mausoleum. The chandelier in the main hall. Right, this is the plastering works to the soffit of this main hall in this mosque. A very tiny the dome. Remember the green domes. Then this is right at the topmost high level of the dome soffit of this. And this is where the tombs of this Shah Ne'mat-ollah Villa, right? Wali. Some of the decoration between these mausoleums. closer view of these mausoleums. So you can see the Islamic inscriptions. This is one of the entry for you, and you notice that the door where the lady is standing, walking out. This is one of the so-called the ancient wooden doors that you can find in this mausoleum, which is actually the main attractions as well. The soffit is equally interesting at this entrance. Now here, the so-called the ancient dong. A close-up view. Well, that end my today episode, and also the last travel episode to Iran. And just a preview of what I'm going to share with you in the coming episodes. I'm in the middle of preparing my travel journey to China again, because I've visited China in many occasions. But I'm going to share with you another very unique province, beautiful province. Why preparing this, the beautiful province itself? Next episode, I will just share with you a one episode series of my travel to Turkey. I will bring you into the air to have a view of this Cappadocia, a very unique and natural site, very popular, famous site. It's also another UNESCO natural heritage site in Turkey for next week. Thereafter, we'll move on to our journey to China. So you will have actually been entertained by my travelogue. I will much please you can subscribe, like, and share to your friend and family so that they can be like you, right? Enjoying the virtual tour at the comfort of their home. Meanwhile, in this pandemic era, and while the world is slowly opening up, I hope that you are in good health and strong so that we can travel again. So I shall see you in this coming episode to Turkey on air, on the taking a ride of the hot air balloon. And I'll see you then. Bye.